Hi everyone. In our first four videos, we tried to understand air conditioning. Then we moved on to understand waterproofing. In the last two videos, we tried to understand older waterproofing materials such as tar coal, tar felt, and also newer ones such as APP membranes, polyurethane, and cementitious also. And we also understood in detail about how to waterproof roofs. But we did not discuss why such a strong material like RCC is so prone to leakages. We will understand this now and also understand how to waterproof basements. So let's start. Why does water seep through such a strong monolithic material like an RCC wall? Let us understand this. Normally, in concrete, the water to cement ratio required is 0.23 to 0.25 by weight. What does this mean? This means water divided by cement is equal to 0.23 to 0.25 by weight. But if we prepare concrete with this ratio, then it becomes very stiff and hard. So it is almost not pourable. Hence, extra water is used. You can see in the diagram. Extra water is used to make concrete more workable or pourable. So the ratio used is around 0.4 to 0.6. Concrete contains cement, coarse sand, and aggregate. During setting of concrete, a chemical reaction takes place between cement and water. This reaction is called hydration. But the extra water which we had put to make the concrete more workable does not form a part of this hydration process. This water evaporates and the space occupied by this water becomes empty. This makes the concrete porous. Now this porosity is of two types. You can see that on the left. One is gel porosity and one is capillary porosity. These two types of porosity are represented in a diagram form on the left. It is clear that capillary porosity is more harmful since it links all the pores and lets the water in. So we have now understood why water leaks through such solid surfaces. Now there are three ways of controlling water from entering through the walls. First, to close the pores, which is shown there. Second, to put a layer of non-permeable material from the outside. And third is to put a layer of non-permeable material from inside. Mainly, the first two are used for waterproofing. But the third method of waterproofing from inside is also used in case the first two fail on any occasion. So let us try to understand the first method of how to close the pores. There are certain additives which, when mixed with RCC, can help reduce the water content required and make concrete pourable without that extra water which was required. These materials, these additives are called plasticizers. You can see that on the left. So the hydration process is completed with less water now, thus reduced pores. But these chemical additives can change the setting process and its strength also, hence should be recommended by the structural consultants. There is also a process called injection grouting. In this process, a flowable material is injected as shown on the left to fill the cracks and pores in the concrete. We shall study the various types of grouts later, but for the time being, we have to understand that pores can be treated with additives and grouts. The second method for waterproofing is to put a layer of waterproofing material from outside. Let us study this in detail now. Let's first understand the sequence of waterproofing work in case of a basement. It is very important for all of you to know the sequence or stages of waterproofing for the basements. Then later we can study the materials which are used for the waterproofing of basements. After the excavation is complete for any basement, the earth is rammed and leveled and preparation is done for laying the PCC. Once the PCC is laid, we have a completely leveled and finished surface which becomes the primary surface to lay waterproofing on. Waterproofing needs to form a protective layer all around the basement, the bottom of the raft and the RCC walls. The surface now is thoroughly cleaned. This is a very important step and is done by sometimes water jets, etc. also. Then the waterproofing layer is applied. This application is carried beyond the raft outline for up till around 12 inches. You can see that in the diagram. The next step is to protect this waterproofing first with a geotextile membrane. It's a fabric, geotextile fabric, and then with a 2-inch layer of PCC, since a lot of work will be happening over this surface. Reinforcement is tied for the raft, then casting for raft is done, and then we are ready to start work on the RCC walls. The RCC walls are casted too, and finally the basement roof is also casted, and mostly all the dirty work is over. Then we go back to our waterproofing, which we had left at the PCC below the raft. You can see the diagram now. A fillet is made, which is called galta in local language, on the edge of the PCC and also on the edge of RCC as shown in the figure. Then the waterproofing is wrapped around the RCC as shown in the figure and finally continued up till the ground level. We shall talk about the detail at this point later. For now, let us go back to the materials used for waterproofing for any basement. But before that, we must understand that all external surfaces of concrete needed shuttering, and this shuttering was oiled before use. This oil sticks to the concrete sometimes. So once the shuttering is removed, this sticks to the shuttering. So sometimes it is necessary to do sandblasting also and chemical cleaning also to remove this oil. Now, cleaning of the concrete surface is extremely important for the waterproofing layer to stick to the RCC surface. Let's now understand the materials used for this waterproofing. 30 years back, we used to use Kota stone with chemicals added to the mortar and the joints. This was a very popular method and is still used in a lot of government projects. Once the PCC was laid, the Kota stone, which was roughly 1 inch to 1.5 inch thick, was laid with mortar mixed with a waterproofing compound. The waterproofing compound was never disclosed by the vendor, but it was a chemical additive which was mixed with cement to form the mortar. The stone was laid in a staggered form, you can see that on the left, and was placed 1/2 inch apart. So there was a gap between two stones. This 1/2 inch groove was further grouted with a chemical, again mixed with cement. Over this, a 2 inch thick protection layer of PCC was laid. Again, this PCC was mixed with a waterproofing compound. The waterproofing vendors used to keep the chemical a secret, but it was evident that they used one of the additives made by Seco, which was then a very popular company for waterproofing chemicals. This method is still being followed by some government organizations and is also listed in the CPWD list of items for waterproofing. Though this is not a fail-proof material or procedure, the Kota stone required curing too for 4 to 6 days. So it lengthened the procedure also. Similar treatment was given for the walls, and a 1 inch thick plaster was laid over it for protection. This plaster too had chemicals mixed in it. This was a very, very labor intensive method, and quality of workmanship had to be controlled for effective waterproofing. This used to be called the tank method of waterproofing. We have used this in a lot of our projects for almost 20 years, from 1983 to almost end of 2000, and never found it to fail. The methods used in modern times are more reliable and need lesser time and efforts. Sometimes, and some methods are even cheaper, but others are more expensive also. Nowadays, mostly two types are popular. First is liquid membrane, and the second is preformed membranes. If you remember, in our first video on waterproofing, we had studied about tar coal and tar felt. These become brittle with time and hence were not very popular for basements. In our second video, if you remember, on waterproofing, we had discussed polyurethane. This was the liquid membrane, and in the same video, we had discussed APP membranes. which are called preformed membranes. Though these are very popular for roof waterproofing, but for basement waterproofing, even cementitious coatings are popular. One big reason is that cementitious coatings are less costly and are also suitable for areas which undergo less expansion and contraction, since they are not exposed to the sun. And the second reason is that they can take care of general dampness where water table is not very high. Hence, there is almost no water pressure from below. But for the walls, the cementitious membranes are generally not relied upon, and here more trust is bestowed upon other liquid membranes such as PU, etc., or APP preformed membranes are used with either cold application or self-adhesive types. We have already discussed these in our last video, and the process of application is the same. Even the stages are the same as explained in the section. In liquid membranes, there are other materials also, such as epoxy, you can see that on the left, acrylic, and natural rubber coatings. In preformed membranes, again there are other materials such as HDPE, high density polyethylene, or EPDM, ethylene propylene diene monomers. You can see all these on the left. And lately, sodium bentonite is also very popular. The specialty about this material is that when it comes in contact with water, it swells up to almost 18 times and forms an impervious gel. Now, a self-study about all these materials is needed by all of you, since if we start talking about these materials in detail, this video will never end. But yes, you are free to ask questions on our mail ID, and we shall be happy to give you more information on all these materials. For the time being, it will suffice to know that APP membranes and PU still remain the most popular materials even for basements. There are other things which need more of our attention, and these are related to the construction joints and materials to be used for sealing these joints to make the basement more waterproof. We shall understand these in our next video. We shall also understand DPC, which I had mentioned earlier, and we shall also understand injection grouting, since this is a very important process in case external waterproofing for basement fails. It is very difficult to re-excavate and work from outside because, first of all, it is very expensive and sometimes it is not possible at all. We shall further understand how expansion joints are taken care of in larger projects. Our mail ID is mentioned below. Please feel free to ask questions. Once again, I will not forget to thank my team, Shubham, Kanika, Monica, and Pooja, for data collection and presentation, without which this video would not have been possible. Our next video will end this topic, waterproofing. Till then, bye, take care.